And I would believe, you know, I deceived myself by telling myself, this church is the fourth man. You know, it's called self-deception. Now, there's some things I just like being deceived by. So I don't want you to try and rehabilitate me. I don't want you to try to get me on detox. I'm just intoxicated on that. This is the fourth man.
Amen.
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 Church.
Yes, yes. Amen.
I just believe this is the best tonight can believe.
Yes, amen. Amen. Amen.
I choose to believe this.
Amen.
I wish I had some believers with me.
Yes.
But I choose to believe.
Amen.
That we come to worship God tonight.
Yes. Amen.
Jesus, hallelujah. Bless the Lord.
Thank you, Jesus. And
God can say anything to me except one sentence. Mm-hmm. He's not allowed to say to me, depart.
Right.
Come on.
But he can see anything that he wants.
Hallelujah, Jesus. Hallelujah, Jesus. Hallelujah, Mama Masia. Hallelujah, Jesus. Hallelujah, Marabasa. Hallelujah, Jesus. Hallelujah, Jesus.
Let's worship Jesus.
Hallelujah, hallelujah.
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 Thank you, God.
Hallelujah. Chapter 16 of the book of Luke. I'm going to ask you all to read for me. In fact, Sister Espinosa, can I read for me? Get your Bible. Get a microphone. You have to read for me because I put my voice on hold. My voice on hold.
Amen.
God gave you guys a vocal system. Turn mine down, so you got to do it for me. Amen. You got to read together. Amen. Don't just look at the Bible, read what you're going to say. Chapter 16 of the book of Luke. Amen. It's a blessing to have your voice available to you.
Amen.
Chapter 16 of Luke from verse 1 to 13. Read thus.
And he said also unto his disciples, there was a certain rich man which had a steward, and the same was accused unto him that he had wasted his goods. And he called him and said unto him, how is it that I hear this of thee? Give an account of thy stewardship, for thou mayest be no longer steward. Then the steward said within himself, what shall I do? For my Lord taketh away from me the stewardship. I cannot dig. To beg I am ashamed. I am resolved what to do, that when I am put out of the stewardship, they may receive me into their houses. So he called every one of his Lord's debtors unto him, and said unto the first, how much owest thou unto my Lord? And he said, 100 measure of oil. And he said unto him, take thy bill, and sit down quickly, and write 50. Then said he to another, and how much owest thou? And he said, 100 measures of wheat. And he said unto him, take thy bill and write 80. And the Lord commended the unjust steward because he had done wisely. For the children of this world are in their generation wiser than the children of light. And I say unto you, make to yourselves friends of the mammon of unrighteousness, that when ye fail, they may receive you into everlasting habitations. He that is faithful in that which is least is faithful also in much. And he that is unjust in the least is unjust also in much. If therefore you have not been faithful in the unrighteous mammon, who will commit to your trust the true riches? And if you have not been faithful in that which is another man's, who shall give you that which is your own? No servant can serve two masters, for either he will hate the one or love the other, or else he will hold to the one and despise the other. You cannot serve God and mammon.
The Lord bless us reading of this word.
Hallelujah, Jesus.
Thank you,
Jesus.
Praise God. You may be seated. And my title tonight is Preparing for the Future Challenges.
Jesus.
Preparing for the future challenges. There's a study I'm going to be doing with you later on. Why do we have struggles? We're Christians. And when I came in the church, I came in with a bag of problems. Mm-hmm. I had a bag full of them. Mm-hmm. I don't know how God's going to deal with them. Didn't bother me. I heard he's going to work magic and miracles, so let's see what he would do with them. But I came in with my baggages and my problems and my situations. And so I brought it to Jesus. I said, Lord, I want you to see what you can do with it. I want to advise all of you, if you're smart, make sure you don't miss nothing I say. Both mothers, fathers, sisters, and brothers, you will live to regret it. Listen to me. I have a word from the Lord. Amen. You have the power to hear the word of God. All right? Now, I found out that life was not going to be as easy as I thought it would be. And they didn't tell me either that there were going to be crosses. In fact, I didn't know what a cross is. To be a cross would be the stick. That's not a cross. That's a scaphosis. A cross is reversals, sufferings, situation of injustice. Paul lists a whole long list of them and said, what will separate me from God? And he named a whole long list of things in Corinthians that would interfere with his walk with God. But he says, none of these things move me. Now they come, cut my life dear. God have to test us before we can rest with him. The disciples did something to Jesus, and they thought they got off the hook. They deserved it when they arrested Jesus. He said, I'm going to get you for that. And John stick it up with them. John went right through the trials, the imprisonment, the nailing on the cross. He was right there when they nailed him, when he gave his ghost. He could even say, son, there's your mom. Mother, there's your son. Take her home. Then he died. And when he did that, came back from the dead, it all came back to life to him. And he says, one of you here will not see death until I return. Mm-hmm. And boy, start trying to figure out who. And he turned right to Peter, the first deserter, and said, you? You're going to glorify me? They're going to take you places you don't want to go. They're going to tie you up and do things to you. In other words, if you plan to go to heaven with me. So the time they crucified Peter upside down, they nailed him. Every one of those apostles, if you study their lives, they died martyrdom. Mm-hmm. Every one, except one. The guy that stuck it out. And stayed with Jesus. You know, the Lord says, I'm going to get those boys. They deserted me. They left me on the cross alone. But I'm going to get them. And he got them. They all died. Mm. They hung some. They crucified some. They saw some in two. They flared them. But they made it. They made it. Because mm-hmm. they told them. He told them, if you love your life, you're going to lose it. If you lose your life, you'll save it. And they know they can come back to life. So, the mere fact he came back to life was a blessing to them. This is a very difficult parable. If you read on your own, you're going to think, Jesus, you've gone crazy. And that's part of Jesus' teaching. It doesn't make sense sometimes. But you have to be careful how you read Jesus' stories, because you may think he's endorsing what he's not endorsing. Mm. This servant has a job, and whatever he was doing, he wasn't done right. So somebody squealed on him, they rat on him, mm-hmm. told his boss that he's not being faithful and that he's wasting his goods and his substance and such like. And so the master says, look, I'm going to fire him. Mm. I'm going to fire him. Mm. I'm going to fire him. And the servant heard about it, eavesdropped. When he heard about it, even the word, he knew all the clients of his master. It came up with a weird idea. I'm going to go tell those guys, hey, how much you owe my boss? He says, 100, we're at 50. What's he owe? Maybe he's going to get the size boxes, creditors list. Amen. And the Lord is telling him what he knows this guy's doing. And the boss doesn't know it. And they thought his boss told him to do that. But he's doing it on his own. And here's why he's done it. He said, I'm about to lose my job. And I know when I lose my job, I can't beg the employer to take me back. I can't beg. I got too much ego, too much pride. I'm not going to beg. So what can I do? I'm going to turn my boss's creditors into my friends. So that when I lose my job, they can either give me another job. Or when I have a need, I can talk to them and they'll help me. Because I'd be a scratch your back. You know, you scratch my back, and I scratch your back. And the Lord said, this guy is smart. The Lord used him to judge us. To judge us. Where's your girlfriend? Where's she at? Why? She didn't have the stomach. The devil didn't want to hear this. Sorry, I say that. All right. Amen. It's his girlfriend. He's engaged to her. So you better listen, we're really good for her. Hallelujah, because she should be here. Amen. Anyway, the Lord says, the people of this world are wiser than the children that belong to the kingdom of God. I don't like that statement.
No.
I wish in my life I could change that.
Right.
I wish I could do something that God could say, well done, thou good and wise servant. And it's in challenges that people prove who they are and their worth and what they are all about. I have no idea if Sister Nina knows she was marrying into. I don't think she knows. Take a chance. Now she'll have to look back and try to figure out, did I do the right thing or not? I was expecting her to scream, yes! But she didn't. So obviously, she's contemplating on whether she did the right thing or not. It was not spontaneous. Amen. If I have to agitate it, it wasn't real. So obviously, she's still debating if she made the right move. Well, I'm not debating, I'm satisfied. Difference of opinion here. Amen. But the Lord says he's smart. He's planning for the future. And for the future, he said, look, I'm going to see if I can survive when I'm either fired or laid off. In other words, my work does not define me.
Right. Amen.
I define my work. It was just a job. And that's not the end of my life. I will find another way to survive.
Amen.
And that's what I want to talk about tonight.
Yes, amen.
Survival of the fittest.
Praise
the Lord. Let's worship God.
Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank
when the pastor speaking, make sure you're always present to hear what he's saying, because you need to hear. Number two, record what he's saying, because I'm telling you, God is talking through him to you.
Yes.
A lot of folks make that mistake, and they live in perils. And never become a pearl. So I'm trying to help those who want to listen. I don't care what you do, but on that day, tonight, it's up to you. Amen. If you get smart and don't miss one word, sit on the edge like Mary and sit at the feet of Jesus, I want to hear everything he has to say.
Amen.
Or get involved in the kitchen if you want to. Get tied up in the bathroom or in the other room in the chamber if you want. It's here. It's your problem, but I'm not talking to you.
Yeah.
That's through the feet of Jesus. You can learn.
Hallelujah. Thank
make
you.
Some correction in your life and survive.
Yes.
Because there are challenges.
Yes. Yes.
Amen. Yes. Let's worship God.
Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Praise
you can't see the future, and I can't see the future. Amen. The future is unseen, but we can prepare for it. And only God alone is the same yesterday, today, and forever.
Amen.
Yesterday gives people depression. Mm-hmm. Amen. Amen.
Amen. Amen.
Today give people, what do they give them? Fear. And tomorrow give them anxiety and panic attack. But with Jesus Christ, not so. I'm not looking back, I'm not looking forward, I'm looking upward. You need to squeeze out of the pastor's message everything you can get out of that juice out of that orange.
Come on. Oh, yes.
Squeeze it. Don't make the minister your enemy. Make him your friend. Make what he has to say what you love and want to hear. Otherwise, you are a fool.
Yes. Amen.
You're a fool because God chose to speak to you by his word. Amen.
Amen.
Now, I'm going to talk to you very frankly, you mothers. You can use your baby as an excuse to excuse if you don't want to hear what the preacher has to say. Mm-hmm. But you're a fool if you do that. I've seen that before in this church, and they're backslidden.
That's right.
They're lost.
That's right.
Out there in the market, losing their soul because they never learn the value of thus said the Lord.
Yes, amen.
If there's anything, I need a word from the I need to be in the Shekinah presence.
Yes, amen.
I want my kids to feel the presence.
Oh, hallelujah.
I want to hear the pastor's beat. I want to feel his heartbeat. Mm-hmm. I don't want nothing. You know, I saw yesterday, my wife, I said, I don't even want to take it for a cheap dinner. Cheap dinner, but I like it. And we went upstairs for a cheap dinner at a shopping mall. I like their cheap dinner. Tastes good. And I sat down there. While I'm going in, I saw this ex-saint kid stoned out of its mind.
Oh, Jesus.
Now, I don't know if somebody should run, scared what I should do. Because the kid is bigger than me. That's huge. Mm. And I thought, why did you brought this kid in the world? And then dropped it off like that and walked away.
Oh, Jesus.
And I remember a service like this, some foolish statement that mother made. Mm-hmm. And took that kid down the road of destruction. And I thought, the kid said, Pastor Dingley, I didn't recognize the kid there, but we're staring like this. We're staring at each other like that. Mm. He said, Pastor Dingley, I thought, is that you? He said, yes. And my heart goes, he said, one night I tried to come to church, but I passed out before I even had close to the door. I was laying on the floor, passed out. I said, you're still coming? He said, oh, well, they dragged me away. I was on the ground. That's not why you brought your sons and daughters in the kingdom of God. They better hear the voice of the preacher.
Hallelujah.
They better see you accept instruction.
Yes, amen.
A lady said on the radio today, said, I'm infested with a disease. It called respect for parents. Mm-hmm. On the radio, what parenting on the radio. Mm-hmm. The program about parenting and the value of parenting. And how kids are spoken to like adults. Talk about their parents like adults, an equal partner, not with respect. And they grew up that way. She said, oh, but I'm so glad. This is an educated, learned person says, I'm so glad I belong to the era where I was trained. And now I have a disease, I can't get rid of it. It's called respect.
Hallelujah.
For adults. Planning for the future. If the Lord tarry, this building will still be here. It will outlive me and outlive you. But I hope the kids of this church will survive.
Hallelujah.
I hope they will survive.
Amen.
I'm talking from experience. I've been before a church school, and one of those kids are lost.
Mm-hmm.
Every one. I'm going to tell you something God showed me. And then I was listening to Home Missions missionaries on website. And there's a couple which I know went to Bible school, and I won't call their names. And they're in a province of ours, and they wanted to link up with me a lot. But the husband said, the father said, you says, Neil is taller than me. I'm more liberal than Neil. You stay with him, and we talk for a while. Now, he's pronounced, he's very prominent in our organization. And his wife was telling the story. She said, look, we have to go to this ungodly city where they're wicked perverts. We had to go there to our church. And I fear for my kids. And she says, I'm going to do this to my kids based on the general trend. And the Lord told her, no. I'm going to stop here for the time being. Let her ask me what the Lord told her, and I'll tell you later on. All right? Clap your hands to Jesus. I tell my missionaries, get on that website and listen to what their testimonies are. Because we can learn from others' life, rather make the same mistake, learn from their success and their failures.
Amen.
Don't repeat them. Amen. Just don't repeat them. Clap your hands to Jesus. The lesson of the ant. Learn it. The lesson of the ant. On my way home today from church, talking to my wife, I said, honey, you realize that Israel never thanked God for anything? Never. They left Egypt. They pinned gold. God did a favor. Gold, silver, brass, you name it, that on them. And church, we read Psalm 78. Remember, the people you're reading about are people loaded down with gold, silver, diamond, precious pearls. Are you with me? And listen to Psalm 78. Just read it. For me, you know. And then, forgive me, folks. I can tell my wife about my childhood days and my legacy that I exposed to. And all the difference is that I dare not walk in the realm of that chapter. Because Jesus didn't have to do what he did. I don't care how rough things are, there's something in your life worth shouting about.
Oh, yes.
There's something worth shouting about.
Amen.
And rather than focus on that negative, focus on positive.
Yeah. Amen.
And that would bring on the rest.
Amen.
Praise the Lord.
Amen.
But the ant is known for the future. Amen. The ant, in some way, I think Sister Kim Mom said, if you pour poison on the ant, they'll take it back to the colony where they come from. And I wish to God our saints get exposed to people of success and come back with good stories.
Yes.
And not with bad stories.
Yes.
Amen. I don't want the 10 spy spirit.
Right.
I want the spirit of the 2 spies.
Yes.
I said, we can.
Mm-hmm.
We will.
Yes.
We got proof to prove it.
Yes.
You don't believe it, look at this. You haven't been there, but I've been there. Here's a fruit right here. We can do it. All right? But there are two types of future. God, let me know tonight that everybody in this church will be Acts 2:38, live for God, do the right thing. You have an eternal future. I'm not going to talk to you about that. It's like singing to the choir. You are saved, sanctified, blessed, glorified, on your way to heaven. I'm talking about living on earth.
Amen.
Life under the sun.
Yes.
Until you get up there, you got to leave with life under the sun. Amen.
Amen.
All right? But when you read Psalm 78, prayerfully, think about your family. Psalm 78. It's about handling hard times. Amen. Now, I don't know how to do this right here, but this lad was dealing with the prospect of a layoff. I promise when I come to you to do the best research I can so you don't have to say I made a mistake. Now, you can always check me out. You should. You should not accept nothing I say blind. You shouldn't. You have a right to check the pastor out. That's your safety.
Yes.
Amen. The only one person infallible is Jesus Christ.
That's right.
Amen.
Amen.
It's just the you love that needs to be the difference. Are you handling it? I'm not the Pope. Oh, I said I'm not the Pope. I'm not the Pope. He has no hope. He's full of dope. Amen. That's free advertisement. All right. But look, let's get back to ourselves here. The most difficult conversation. Since I've been married, I don't think I've ever had a conversation with my wife. I've been fired. Have I ever said that? I said I've been laid off. No, she don't know me as that. But before I married my wife, that was a story of my life. Fired, laid off, kicked out. I've been there, done that, lived that, can write the lyrics on it, make a CD on it. You want my DVD? But something happened. I guess a woman straightened me out, I guess. So it's good to have a good woman that can straighten you out. Thank you. They're good balancing weight. Nothing on the balance puts a weight on it. You help me out. Hey, this guy's grateful. Anybody else?
Yeah,
you mean your wife didn't help you? God, come on, guys. Slap you for not Slap you for not being there. And somebody said, well, I'm not married. I don't need to know this. Just till you get married. My wife, a lot of stuff, she was planning for her marriage a long time ago. She had a whole bunch of stuff she put away. I didn't know that. China, Japanese stuff. All kind of stuff. You know what I had? Bills, problems, heartaches. I didn't tell her that. She didn't know that. I need that from her. She married me blind. Amen. Hallelujah. You know, when my wife married me, I had more bumps than bumps in the road in Canada. And I thought, boy, if she married me like this boy, then either she's blind or she's falling in love. I think God just blinded her eyes. Amen. You know, they told my wife, look what she went and picked up. I mean, you know, pick it mean, you know, pick it from the dirt bin. But you know what? I outlived them. And those who chide her are still barren. You don't curse David dancing in the window.
That's right. Amen.
God will shut your womb them. I said, God will shut your blessing them.
Right.
And they're not married today. And my wife and I are cruising all the time and watching them. Ooh, where are you going to get cruised? Where are you going to get cruised? Same guy, cruised. Do you wish you married? Yeah, but it's too late. Yeah. She got him. Hello.
Amen.
Praise God. Make those people who didn't marry you wish they had. Ooh. Lord have mercy. Lord have mercy. You guys have no sense of humor? Where do you guys come from? It get rougher than this, but I'm going to laugh now. Can we cry later? But he's looking about his security. And what I hear him saying is, my security is a challenge. And my sense of security is in question. He said, I don't want to be laid off and be stressful. I don't want my pay to roll back and be depressive. I don't want to face downsizing and be fearful. I want to be demoted and feel anxiety, he says. I don't want to be fired and get so angry. I don't want to face obsolescence and have to be antisocial at home. He says, I don't want to be as mad as hell. Amen. Face a panic attack. So, he made an unprecedented decision. He said, look what I'm going to do. I'm going to do some planning for the future. Amen. Do you know that? If you don't plan, you plan to fail. Mm-hmm. Let's worship God.
Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus.
I can imagine. You know, I'm a counselor. I didn't counsel before. And you know, I'm trying to get out of it now because life is moving on. But you know what? It's hard for a man or a breadwinner, whoever they are. Let's be politically correct. The breadwinner. They. Could be he or she. One doesn't know. They have to come and give the bad news. Hey! Especially if you don't drink and get drugs in your system. The news is, I'm not sure tomorrow I have a job. Can you imagine the family response? How should they respond? Can you imagine the tense environment, the tenseness in the home? Can you imagine how the old problem of the past begins to surface to the top? Can you imagine that? And you can't imagine now the relationship is on the rock. And you begin to feel inordinate affection. Pretty soon, you know, he or she is not handsome or pretty anymore. All I see is spots and wrinkles. They've been hair unkept, uncombed. Tension. Can you imagine getting on top of my nerves. Stop calling my name. Frequent disagreement over any little thing. Or the silence treatment, or the loss of appetite. I don't want you cooking. Sorry, I don't want you to eat. Well, I did eat it. Well, I don't want him. Sorry, I don't want it. Brother Jackson called me that night. I said, Brother, I found something. You talk about fight, flight, or freeze. But I found a fourth one. Are you talking about the fourth one? Where you see mask and they'll tell you. But then the kids become a nuisance to you. Partners are upset over the way that your kids are treated. Housekeeping become a grounds for criticism, abusive words, eh? And, you know, the blind spot become their main issue today, or the blame name game, and all that breakup is not hard to do.
How about a bridge over troubled waters?
Like a bridge.
What are you doing on that bridge? I'm running from troubled waters.
Love lasts cold, like soup. Amen. And it's getting each other away. Amen. Now, what shall you do? I'm going to show you something here on my board. And I'm going to go back and forth. And it's going to upset a bunch of you because you don't understand the love your pastor had for you. You're going to find out one day it was too late. But he was trying to help you.
Yes, amen.
He was trying to give you something that you'll never get on your own. You don't even have it, now you need it. It's like Acts 2:38, a scripture study. I want to touch that. I developed a couple. A nuclear couple. We're in a nuclear age now. Mr. Joe and Miss Susie. They're married. They're not cohabiting. They're married. I said they're married.
Amen.
It's not him and Shim. It's he and she. Here she is. She's 35, 36 years old. He's 35. Okay. She used to have kids. So you need. And they have, God promised them 70 years in life. Thank you. Move my God. Move if you want out of the way. Move over there if you want over there. Oh, I see. So here they are. She's 36, he's 35. And by the way, if you love somebody, age is irrelevant.
That's right.
Amen. As long as you're not marrying a little cradle.
That's right.
Don't rob the cradle, please. You don't want to marry a grandpa. Looking for dentures for him. You don't want to do that. You heard a story about this 80, 90-year-old woman dating this guy was also 90 years old. The first time went on a date, and she came home mad. And the kids asked, Mom, why are you so upset? Was he being fresh? No. He wasn't getting fresh. Then why so mad with him? Oh, you gotta wake him up. The whole time waking him up. He's nodding off on me. It's the first date after so many years. But they have a son and a daughter. And they have a life cycle to live, hopefully to the right age of 70 or beyond that. The boy is 8 years old. The girl is 12 years old. That means, listen now, this couple here have to start focusing their life and future on the future of these kids. When they had no kids, it was all of them alone. But now the governance of their finance and security is in the hand of these kids. Otherwise, you brought them here to be destroyed. So this parenting knows that it's going to take another, for a 12-year-old girl, another 6 more years before she's on her own, 18 years old. For this boy, another 10 more years before he's 18. That's how long they have to be providing for this kid. It costs money. It costs money. Now, are these two going to work to take care of these two? Or will one of these stay home today? Sometimes the man stay home and the girl go to work? Or vice versa? I'm not here to tell you what to do. But let's go to Proverbs 24, verse 3 to 6. Do I have the same Rita still? Or do they retire on me?
I'm here.
Read, please, Rita. Read, please. Where's your microphone? Read, please. Proverbs 24, verse 3 to 6.
Through wisdom is an house builded, and by understanding it is established. And by knowledge shall the chambers be filled with all precious and pleasant riches. A wise man is strong, yea, a man of knowledge increaseth strength. For by wise counsel thou shalt make thy war, and in multitude of counselors there is safety.
Wow. Amen. We don't know how wise these couples are, but time will tell. So I look at these couples here. Here's a dad. Here's the mother. And the question is, who's working, who's not working? In this case, I put different scenarios. The dad is working, mom is not. Dad's not working, mom is working. Dad's not working, mom is not working. Or the dad died and mom not working. Or dad is working and mom died. Each of those represent challenges. Each of those represent challenges. Now, you don't think about it until it hits you. But you can think about it before it happened to you. And I'm here tonight to provoke you to do that. Because a happy saint makes for a good church. Amen. Because your home life does affect this church. When you walk through that door, you affect this church. And we see you're part of the faith of God. You affect us. All right? And we want you to be successful. Now, this family should expect a quality home life where they have a home, transportation, take care for them, moving around and get to work, etc., food, education, insurance, saving, and retirement. A good family plan for that. If they don't do that, they're not planning for their need. They're living out by chance or living by plans. I heard this week on the news, kids were eating grass, tree leaves. It reminded me of a king who had, for 7 years, ate grass like an ox. Survival of these kids depends on the employability of the parents. Otherwise, government has to step in. And the government become foster parents for your family. And then you become a file and not a person. And then they come to breaking up and the breakdown of the home. Now, this life cycle here, folks, you are going through this right now, whether you like it or not. And I'm just trying to make it more visual for you. Amen. I am making it visual for you that you are right now in this block right here. You may not want to admit it, or you want to be off to the sand, but look at it real good and ask yourself, and you know, if you watch these charismatics on video, everybody taking notes, everybody's drawing stuff, but Pentecostals, they're so smart, they have high retention rate, and low forget-me-not, and I don't believe nothing they say, but they walk up the door, they forget everything they saw. And they fall in the abyss. These are, they're not wise. My people are not wise. This is not just to you alone. Everybody in this world goes through this. Everybody, but everybody don't have the same fate. Some are victim of challenges, and others challenge victims. Victimized challenges. Amen. All right? Did you know mom and dad is constantly in a decreasing earning employability as time goes on? They constantly are losing their ability to earn money. And they're moving more and more towards the poverty line. As their age. So it is important what they do with this 34, 35 years got left. They can spend all their life taking care of these kids, but I gotta tell them something here. When that kid turned 18 and found the person they love, you know, abandoned you. Mark it down on your calendar. I said your kid would abandon you at age 18 when they found the person they love. And you gave up all your career and your goal for all them. And they don't even decide what senior citizen home you should go to. You're just a nuisance. And yet if I tell you not to spend all that years on them, it will offend you. Woo-hoo. Nobody say amen?
Amen.
You see, pastor is not just preaching, it's also pestering. Pestering in facts you don't want to hear. And figures. Now look at this chart real good. Because if you understand this, you won't need a psycho. You won't need a social worker. It's just common sense. Then you got 10 years to take care of this boy, and what? 6 years to this girl, and they're gone. And by the way, they can sue you for continuing education beyond that. The law can't allow them to do that. And you have to do it if you have the money. And the more you do, the poorer you get. And they don't care if you're hungry. And they don't care if you have the ability. All they want is, well, gimme. I'm in top. Hello. So the question is dad skilled or unskilled? Did dad drop out of school and never finish school? Did she finish her grade school before she got married? Does she go into marriage with a higher education and high employability? Or does she go in there undereducated, unskilled? And if the guy gets sick and have no availability, she got to go on the bread line, food bank. And the sad part is, he never wanted me to stir her up to go get a job. And all she does is sleep, get fat, sleep, fat. Wow, you work your fingers off. If the one that spends the money don't work the money. It's amazing. It's amazing what mental link can do. Ooh-ba-loo. That's not good?
Yes, amen.
Zachary, hear me?
Yes.
What kind of girl are you going to marry? You better know.
Educated.
You better start writing right now. What are you gonna marry? Dummy? What do you know? How do you know that? All right. So look at this chart real good. Now I invented this chart. I was gonna draw it by electronic, that's nice to have. Because when a couple come and see me, you know, this is about parenting. This is about family economics. This is about survival. The lad says, I got to think about my future. And Jesus said, he's smart. And wisdom built a house. And by wise counsel, we go to war. I'm going to war against the inflation. Devaluing of the currency. I'm going to go to war against the fact that I can. You guys don't know this. Now, this family here, that's a home. How many of you right now have an insurance policy that if I get laid off, they'll pay my mortgage till I'm reemployed? Don't show your hands. Now, I don't mean death insurance. When you're dead, it doesn't matter. I mean while you're alive.
waiting 29 months for a job. I can't find one. You know why you won't have that insurance? Because your grub's paying $60 a month. My next 10 years. You're betting against yourself. I will not be laid off. Not fired, laid off. You get fired, you're not covered. You get laid off, you're covered. How many know that plan existed? Let's see those hands. And how many, don't forget it after this, if you have a home already involved in that, just in case they get laid off. Because you're not eternally secure in that job. Forget it. Even the man that owned it, knowing he stayed there forever. One day you will be let go. You will be let go. Are you planning for that? No. Then you're going to be hit by a challenge. You're rocking down. Bam! Suddenly hit. And the first thing you do is drop out of church. It was God's fault. And he's nothing to do with it. He just didn't plan for it. Because we're Christian doesn't mean we're exempt from challenges.
That's right.
Can I move on?
Amen.
You sure? No one is poor until discontent with the means. I don't think I heard it. That's a famous tape. That's on Facebook. No one is poor until discontent with their means. Pastor Neil strikes again. He missed his calling. Art. He's an artist. This more than art. Hallelujah. The more I type, the less mistake I make. But I still make them. Well, they're down to one. I started with a whole bunch, but now they're down to one. Because I'm determined, I don't want to get just a fish. I want to learn how to fish.
Right.
I don't want dependency. I want independence. I want, when you're sleeping, I can still what I want. Hello? Folks, my wife don't know this. Whenever my wife touches me, it's like magic. And she would stand there. I said, touch me, honey, touch me. What's wrong with you? Touch me. Just one touch, that's all it took.
Yes.
So, just one, that's all it took. I don't want to look, I want to touch. You mean your partner don't have any kind of touch?
Mm-hmm.
My God, go grease their hands. Amen. She's mad and I'm talking about her. You know I can do that? She can't beat me up. You can or she can. Here, come on with me. All right. Typical profile. End of life. Beginning of life. This is my hierarchy of needs. You have one, church.
That's right.
Before you got married, you were a problem. When you got married, you married the trouble. When you have kids, you married the crisis. And the more kids you have, the more catastrophe you feel.
That's right.
And the more you can learn the number 911. Just 1-1-1. I've heard these moms. Oh, I look at a baby, and the first one they have, I never have another. It bites. You know, marriage is like this. A lot of people want to get into it, but multitude want to get out of it. And they're passing each other by the door, wondering, what is wrong? Honey, get out while you can. I hear no amens out there. All right. Salvation. That's already covered. You got it. There's no question about it. You have it. But food and clothing, security, home support from you, teamwork, make dream works.
Yes, amen.
Did you hear me?
Mm-hmm.
Teamwork make dream works. This is very important, husband and wife. Achievements, employability, retirement. You know, I don't know why people look at people's looks when they marry them. Friend, that's the most deceiving thing there is. That's the most powder on there, it's the most cosmetic. The hair is horsehair, it's not even their hair. The teeth is not there, they borrow that from somewhere. And folks, it's all gonna be gone. And all you're left with is the carcass. Holy bone, Batman! That's all I got left. Look at that nice wavy hair the guy has. In 5 more years, we'll be gone. Look at the comb, it's just falling out little by little. I'm telling you, I'm on my way out. My wife told me she didn't want the bald-headed guy, let her see it with. And go from bad to worse. But she's stuck. Amen. Get her eyes off my head and get her eyes on Cruz. Whew! No amens? Amen. I see you. Wish I had a bad cold than I have, right? Look at this, folks. You have to plan for salvation. You have to plan for your food and clothing.
That's right.
If you don't plan for these, it's just not going to happen.
Right. Amen.
And these are planning for the future. And the last says, I can't beg, I can't dig, I'm going to do something about my future.
Right.
I'm going to make reservations when I'm dropped out of the employment circle. I got some friends to support me. Jesus was making friends with money. That's what he said. What did he say? Make friends with money. You made that fight all bill here? You know, make this habit. Go borrow and get $100 bill and walk around with this. I've never spent it. So you'll never be broke. Try it. Empty wallet, invite empty wallets. You don't believe that? Yes. Get the cards out, get the paper bill in. Most of us right now got more plastic in our car, in our wallet, then we got paper bills in. Wow. And each of one of those are demons ready to attack you. They're waiting for the command to attack you. Look at this, folks. You can rearrange his heart if you want to. But how prepared am I for the future and my dependents, my kids, my offspring? Do I have personal security and their security? They're depending on me, however I'm in the world. So my question here is, what do you have that is marketable that can bring them bread and butter on the table? Why should I waste my time in a video game when I can learn how to? A new trade.
Right.
I don't need one, I just can do it.
Mm-hmm.
Put it on hold if I crash this camera and go on something else. Mm-hmm. Train skills. Do I have that? Do I have marked with trained skills? Do I have knowledge? Marked with knowledge? Do I have specialized training that I could use someday? Credentials? In England, Africans, they come from poverty. Friend, they are permanent students. And all the doctors in England are doctors. Or Asians. Not the British. Not the British. Always immigrants. You know what? They know what poverty is. And they learn the value of knowledge. And the people who have it free, those who have it, don't want it, and those who want it, can't get it.
Mm-hmm.
And they'll fight for it. That's what Jacob was like. Jacob said, I don't have it, but I get it anyhow. Esau just got rid of it. God said, I hate him. But Jacob was an opportunist. And he stole it from his brother. Or did he? Just surrendered it to him. what is available in my life. Now, look at this, folks. I want you to compute the following. The potential earnings you have. Am I diversified? Am I staying home waiting for them to call me? I'm going to go to them to let me know. Can you imagine? I want to work as a plumber, and I go to the boss like this. He would laugh at me. I didn't come dressed and look like a plumber. I want to get to work as a dig ditcher. I go there with a tuxedo suit. The guy would laugh at his corner. I got to influence the man. I got to collaborate and negotiate. I'm not going to waste opportunity, which is my greatest asset in life is my age. That's my greatest asset. The greatest asset you have is your age. Once you lose it, you lose earning ability and educatability. All right? And time is a punishing thing. Time punishing you for not making use of this opportunity. It never comes back. Yesterday is forever gone. You can never retract. I almost quit college because I was failing, and I thought, I hang around failures, I hang around those who are succeeding, and I saw what they did and copied them. They went to the library. When the student was given time called SPARE, it didn't mean time to be a shuttle board, it mean go to the library and study. Right. And the guy who wore the passes went to study. So I began to do that. And I made an increase in learning. And I passed. Men did not graduate. In fact, 8 out of 10 didn't graduate. I did, thank God. I walked across that big stadium floor and I graduated, my friend. But it was challenging. But I passed. And it's some of the best job you can think of. All right? Any plans for Sunday off?
I want to ask you now, friend.
Can you live, honestly, on 50% of your wage, even though you don't have to? Only a conscious effort can answer that question. I told someone, listen every week on AM 930 Edmonton, and this guy will give you a protocol, cash is key, and he celebrates getting out of debt. He's got millions and millions of people that call into him. And they bring this scenario to him, and like a doctor of debts. And then says, let's cheer that we got out of our debt. And he would cheer. You think Christians listen to that? Absolutely not. We expect Jesus Christ to come down here and solve it for us, and he won't do it. That brother preached a message here, you guys didn't get the sense of it. He said to the man that was crippled on the bed, are you sure you want me to heal you? Do you know what that meant when I'm going to heal you? After this, you're going to get up your own bed every day. Do your own walking, that stuff, and so on. So, you know, you sure you want to be healed? Now, if you want to keep sorry for yourself and all that stuff, I know a lot of people does that, and they're in trouble right today, still where they are. Do you have a nest egg against being laid off or being fired? Do you have a size, visible safety net to catch you if you're falling? Do you have a lifeboat? Do you really have a coping skill or any emergency for 6 months, unemployment, no funds, no money? Let me go on here. So the question is, missed opportunities. Christians always seem to fail to capitalize on their youth. They think they're Christians going to heaven enough to get educated. When guys tell me that, I don't need insurance for my family because God's going to cover it. I don't need the house anyhow. In fact, in one city, they would give it a house cheap, free, almost free. You wouldn't do it today. You don't own anything. Now, there's a whole plethora of houses built around it. You don't own any of it. I remember in Alberta, where I live in Edmonton, in St. Albert, homestead was free as long as you've been there for 10, 20 years. Mm-hmm. Few people went there because it meant chopping down woods and stay there. Mm-hmm. It was free. Government wanted you to live out there. Now you can't buy a house there. How many opportunities we miss to get educated? Huh? To learn new experiences and skills and improve our skills. We got talented that can be used. It's marketable. Just need development. God knows you have it. Do we take advantage of education program that's free given to us in our city? Kids drop out of school and go back after they're kicked out. They're going to pay for it. Now it was free before. Huh? It was free before. Now they're going to pay for it. Night class. You're paying for it. But before you didn't have to pay for it. Now you're going to pay for it. All right? They see no need for upgrading beyond the status quo. I'm happy, you know, just. This church do not believe that a wife or a Pentecostal husband job is just to bear kids and be barefooted and wash dishes. I do not believe that. If the person believes that's the problem, it's okay, fine about me. But I believe the wife has a lot more value than that.
Right.
She's got a brain, try to use it. Got hands and skill, use it.
That's right.
Get off that bed and go work.
Amen.
Amen.
Because together, dream come through.
Yes, hallelujah.
Sit there saying, praying for God to give you a house. It's not going to happen. You have to go work and get a down payment.
Right. Amen.
Yeah.
Yes.
Didn't anyone know it?
Amen.
Don't blame God for not giving you what you're asking for. He said, go do something better. Don't waste precious time on video games. It's senseless. It's useless. You don't get nothing in return. All right? Failure to read the trend in the economy. There's a handwriting on the wall.
Come on.
The boss is treating you bad. He's planning to fire you. Mm-hmm. Start making. Some plans.
Yep.
Exit plans. Then when he does it, you shock him. I remember my VP used to ignore me for a while, but he was a Christian. But when he saw the handwriting on the wall, they brought a new guy in, and they called meetings and didn't invite him. I left him in his office going through psycho problems, mental grief. He said, Neil, I can see the handwriting on the wall. He started looking for another job before they start firing him. Before they could lay him off, he'd find another job elsewhere. Because they were planning to displace them. You can see the problem coming, and you do nothing about it. And you wonder why God don't help you. Well, God has shown it to you. Hello, look here. Never planned for being fired. Never planned for being laid off. Never, you know, any time for being fired, have 6 months where you just put up a sign, have resume ready to go.
Right?
Huh?
Come on.
Leave a good record behind you when they lied on you. Laid off, you buy the insurance policy for being laid off. Unemployment, we got a nest egg. Sickness, well, you got insurance coverage. Upgrading your status, because you know what? If you don't plan to be better than you are today, the company will get rid of you.
That's right.
Because if you've been always doing what you have been doing, you're not going to change. That's where you're going.
Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus.
This is not meddling. It's about planning for my future.
Thank you, Jesus.
In challenging times. Praise God. All right. When things go wrong, you know what I mean? Where are we surprised? Well, people who don't pay their tithes wonder why God don't bless them. Amen? People who do not and refuse to save 10% of their income say, we can't do it. That's not true. That's a lie. You can do anything you want to. You always do what you want to. Don't you? You always go where you want to. All right? You dream of having kids. Do you need to cost you money to do that? You don't interfere with your employment? You interfere with your age? The only time kids are a benefit to you is when they get older and hopefully help for your retirement program.
But if they don't, you didn't waste your money. And you waste your time on them. Lord, mercy. I don't hear no amens. Amens. I'm right. If they're not part of your retirement program to put you away and take care of you, then you waste all those years taking care of them.
Right.
Companies offer you benefits, and you didn't use it. Companies offer a training program, you bypass it. Sometimes we have to ask the wives, choose it. Is it all sex or all money? Which one do you want? But you can't have both. I'm losing it now. Pastor, you know, we're all married, so you're planning to marry. You're on a slippery slope. Get married and repent at leisure. You know what I said? Get married, repent at leisure. Or get married and enjoy it forever. I work hard for this stress and this tension. I deserve it. I love it. Don't rob me of it. Leave me alone. I love the migraines, headaches, and the mistakes. You guys can't grin anymore? This is pastoring.
Amen.
Yes, amen. And you live with an unemployed person who just sleep all the time and just eat and sleep and eat and eat. There's some folks that eat so much, sleep so much, they can't walk. They're like this. My God, don't get there. Look, folks. Budgeting. I can't budget, Pastor. I ain't got time to budget, and there's not a month to budget. Ants can't even meet. You're right, because they're too far apart. Can I live within my means? I don't think I can, Pastor. I don't make enough. How much is enough? Winners of lottery prove money quantity is not enough.
Right.
Is management.
Yes, amen.
Let's worship Jesus.
Hallelujah.
Is the Bible study okay?
Amen.
I'm trying to help you. Woo! And you can help your children.
Hallelujah.
And you can survive in challenging times.
Yes.
Like faith. We have them. All right. Why some folks fail to see it? In your job, don't let the employer mentor. Be, I need it. Let them need me.
Mm-hmm. Oh, hallelujah, Jesus.
Let them need me.
Oh, hallelujah.
I was at sushi bar with my wife yesterday, and I saw a girl walked in there. I thought, that's the kind of girl to marry. She has a big old book, bigger than the Bible, that thick. And I'm watching her. And she sat down there, she asked, she ordered a meal. And she reminded me going to college, and these girls are going to college. And I'm watching her. And she's doing her homework and assignments. And you saw that. And she did an assignment. And I'm just staring at her. I thought, wow. And she's just gross. And she's just calculating. I thought, so, you know, I'm nosy. When I'm leaving, I said, are you planning to be a doctor? She said, not quite. I was interfering. Now, you know what she's doing? She's not waiting on a man to take care of her. She planned to take care of herself.
That's right.
Marriage is not an escape for financial security. Marriage is for procreation. Oh, Lord. Recreation and communication. Community. I wish I had a textbook for you guys to write, take notes tonight, because you're going to forget everything I'm saying. You're all looking at me like, I remember what the pastor said. I don't believe it. I give a test right now, you'll all fail the first thing. Spell love, V-E-L-O-L. Think about it. Stop blaming life and circumstance and everybody. Now, I put there to make sure you don't go over and slander me. I'm not here to give you advice.
I'm just reasoning with you. Wisdom is not a product of schooling, but of lifelong attempt to acquire it. The key to wisdom is, number one, count the cost before you suffer the loss. Short-term pain for long-term gain. Those who spend the night studying for future, I remember on the airplane, they saw a picture. One kid reading the journal, the stock journal, right? And reading the stock market. Look, kid, number, exactly age, reading the paper. It's out of kid for his age. And the other one playing hockey and playing games and playing around, wasting his time. And they show you, 25 years later, the one with the stock market is on the 50th floor. And the other one sweeping the street. Nothing wrong with sweeping the street, but it all, that's the reward of his wasted life. Dropping out of school is not cute.
That's right.
Amen.
Come on.
Quick bucks at young age is suffering at older.
That's right.
That's right.
You kids listen to me? My years are behind me. Young people, yours are before you. Clap hands to Jesus. Amen. You know, if you guys are all thankful for all this, you're going to invite me Monday, Tuesday, and Thursday, Friday for the next every week for dinner somewhere out. So my wife wouldn't have to cook at all. Thanks for being on top like a cheapskate. No wonder you're in trouble. No wonder you're in trouble. No wonder you can't get ahead. You're afraid to invest in the present. I'll try one more time. Think the pastor every Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday for dinner at your expense. That's about 80%. And the 20% was going to happen to you. It fell by the wayside. I'm just teaching on obedience. But short-term what? Short-term what? Gain? Well, long-term pain. A lot of people go through this. Pastor, why are you saying this? Because God told me my people are not exempt from crisis, from challenges, from struggles. And I give wisdom, book of wisdom, in the book of Proverbs, in the book of Solomon's Ecclesiastes, to teach you for this life. It's written for your life under the sun. I wouldn't go to Proverbs and the book of Ecclesiastes to find out I'd be saved. No, I go to the book of Acts. But I have to face the work experience and life challenges, I'm going to Proverbs and Ecclesiastes, that's the wisdom book. Thank you, folks, that clap your hand. The rest of you got problems, paralysis. Dropping out of school is not cool. It means you wake up to become a fool. Now, folks, here's my example here. A wife and husband, they got dreams, and they should have dreams. You all got dreams. But if you're on a team, the dream will never come through.
That's right.
I got some stats before I talk to you, in case you challenge me. Some stats. These two, they're married, they're a couple. I'm in the perfect case. They're optimistic about life. You got a dream. Their financial goal is one day they're going to own a home and have child support available for their kids. And they dream to do it, so they both begin to work. They have no children and they're saving towards that. They plan pregnancy. They plan parenthood. Now I hear it now. Pastor, do I use the rhythm method or the tube method? I don't care if you use the blue method. I don't care what you do. Well, I'm talking to adults, folks. I'm not going to hide it from you. God created sex. Amen. So if I hear nothing about it, too bad.
Amen.
So listen to me right now. I'm saying to you right now, you got a plan, spacing, mm-hmm. and quantity. Mm-hmm. Otherwise, the more you have, the more cost it costs you. Mm-hmm. Now, if you plan to work all your life for those kids, they didn't have a whole room full of them, have a football team. And then call them the Red Baron or the Oilers or the Flames. No, I'm serious, do it. But don't bring them into the government and expect taxpayers to pay for them.
Come on, that's right.
Some provinces are a welfare state. They allow families to live off it.
Yes.
And they'll never work. And the kids grow up and do the same thing. They go on and on and on and on and on. And they wonder why they're living less. We hate Alberta because it's got too much oil. Move where the oil is.
Yes.
Elijah moved where the barrel of meal was. Yes. He want a drink, go get it. God ain't gonna bring it to him. What he couldn't get, the crow brought, but what the crow don't bring, he will get it. Mm-hmm. Oh, you have to say, Pastor, you're so smart. Oh. Pastor, you listen to me. You live with all that wisdom. My God. Right, Brother Beaton? You can't say amen.
Amen.
I thought you were on my team. But folks, look at this right here. She's working, he's working. And someday she constantly decided, I've earned enough money to have 3 or 4 or 5 kids, so I don't need to work. And this day, I'll secure to the side, take care of the situation. So my husband can keep on working, and he should, till he dies. When he married me, I gave him a Christian worker's license to die. Working. So I'm married to this. A worker's license, yes. Sure about that. To work. Amen. All right. And so he keep on working, but she did put away a nest egg right here. She got more kids. It doesn't affect their dream. Hello? Hello? Mm-hmm. Now, I show the distance between her money and the dream. And his distance between his dream and the money. Can you see that?
Yes.
Now, what if one day they got this strange spiritual revelation from other Papists that she should stay home and everything stays the same way? But it says in the Bible, I must be the keeper of the home. Hello. And so, I deserve every sabbatical rest. So she just stayed at home. She will not work. She could work. She has skills. She's not using it. She should use it. She could help him out.
Yes,
she's not going to do it. Because she said, the Bible says. The Bible says. On the seventh day you rest. So I'm going to rest sabbatical forevermore. And so he works. Look what happened now. The distance between here, between A and B, doubled. Mm-hmm. What's the chance of them getting what they wanted now? Diminish.
That's right.
And then guess what? Mr. Jack, come to church. And all of a sudden, hey, Pastor, I got 5 jobs and I got a house. And pretty soon it bothers you. Well, God loves you more than me. I have heard women and men told me that.
Oh my.
I'm not lying. Mm-hmm. I just met a group after double digit years who literally told me that and scream at us that God didn't love them as he loved the rest of the people in church. Mm-hmm. What you didn't know was they were in a house worth over $120,000. And all they have to pay is less than $50 a month. And all they have to do is pay for the lights and the water. And they wouldn't pay for the light on welfare money they had, and they wouldn't pay for the water, and told their family the church would not help them.
Oh my.
and the family cursed the church. So they lost the house because they wouldn't stay in the house, and they were staying next door in the neighbor's house, telling them the church don't love them. Not in the city. It's only more about it, not here. Mm-hmm. And do they know who they are? They're mentally mad in their head.
Yes.
You can't slander God like that for them. Yeah. And slander is speaking.
Come on, yeah.
And you can't slander the prophecy in the Bible. God is faithful.
Yes,
I said, God is faithful. God is loyal. You and I have got to do what the Bible says, and then God will confirm His word.
Right. Hallelujah.
And when God opened the door, you don't shut it.
Right.
And you don't pout on it.
Right.
One time He gave the loaves to the fishes, next time He said no.
Right.
Is that true?
Yeah.
Next time He said no. Get your own.
Amen.
This church doesn't believe it. Go get your own all.
Amen.
Are we selfish? No. But look what happened right now. He dubbed A plus B now, so he will never get to the place. Let me see that. I want you to understand that, church. For every move we make, the equal opposite move to us, reaction to what we do. Nothing moves without emotion. If you don't spend, save $10 a month, you won't have $120 in the year.
Right.
That's right.
And I'd rather have $120 in a year than zero.
Amen.
Amen.
You want to curse it? Go ahead if you want to. Why if you want to? I won't. Because still, $100 is a lot of money on the stock market. Mm-hmm. Look right here. Examine yourself. Wisdom mean what? Go on, go on. You read this for me, please? Say it in my voice. Come on, please. Read that for me, please. Sister, read it for me, please. What it says out here?
Wisdom, how to use information in maximum benefit.
All right. Knowledge?
Recognize what you don't know.
Ooh. Discretion?
Knowing when to put into action.
Understanding?
Benefit from information
provided.
Provided.
Thank you very much. In other words, I gotta drop my ego, my self-defense here, right? And ask myself, is my house in order? Mm-hmm. I guess unexpected. I guess economic situation. I guess the workplace. I should take my work from work home and study for problems I have to solve tomorrow. On the job. When I get there, I have my solution. I did. My boss told me, you work far beyond your job description. You know why I have to do that? They don't like Christians. Make myself indispensable. Make myself needful. And the world's not stupid. They saw Joseph had something going. And they put him in leadership role. They saw Daniel had wisdom, and they make him the president. And if the world see you got it, they'll take it.
Amen.
How can I leave here offended when the man of God's trying to help me?
Right.
I have my wife, I have my children, my family.
Hallelujah.
I got to learn my lessons from my own mistake and from others.
Yes. Hallelujah, Jesus.
Values simply mean continuing living out what I believe.
Amen.
Integrity means, but, amen? Stop the blaming game. So, some calculation. Mm-hmm. Let's test money and lose. I want every wife who got kids, stop and look at this, please. I'm asking you, if you're married, go get your wife and bring on the front seat if you have to. She needs to see this. Bring your wife on the front seat, brother. Amen? You're in training. Come on up here. Bring your wife up here. I listen to this pastor, breastfeed in church if you have to. I don't care if you breastfeed right there. Amen. Give her the milk right here. Why not give her the milk of the word? Come on, one is liquid, one is literal. Come on. Cup hand somebody. Milk is milk, spelled the same with M-I-L-K. Come on, Sylvia. Oh, she can't give you milk, sorry. Sip Saturday water. Amen. Boy, sip Saturday. I want you folks, look at this right here, folks. I want you guys to look at this, because I got some statistics here. My heart is beating for you. And I worked so hard for you to get this for you. And I'm willing to give you a copy of this. And I'm not telling you what to do with your life. Sit in the front seat, both of you. Sit right here. Amen. These guys went to Bangladesh. I'm so impressed with that. I thought, this is outstanding. There must be a reason why you guys did that. Amen, amen, amen. Now, sister, I'm feeding them milk of the word, and you feed that milk of the breast. It's okay.
Amen.
Is all right? I say amen?
Amen.
First, you guys say amen. What's wrong with you guys?
Amen.
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 I say amen.
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 Amen. It's okay to Pentecost.
Come on.
Amen. This is no disease. That's all right.
Amen.
Look at this, folks. I did a statistical analysis of the impact of lost income. When you fail to plan to calculate the waste of the loss, you never know how much money you've lost. Don't you ever keep your kids home unnecessarily because they're sick.
Right.
Challenge it. Because they're losing education.
That's right.
They're losing information.
Right.
You may be cute now, but they'll curse you later.
Amen.
That you went along with what? The truancy, they call it. Amen. Every family of truancy have dropout kids who are poverty line.
That's people. Right. Absolutely. Amen.
Right. Amen. All right? If you work 40 hours per week or sleep 40 hours per week, how much am I losing? Because my dollar bill is my defense against poverty.
Right.
I want to look at this here. 40 hours per week times $20 per hour equal $800 per week. If you didn't use your wise time in those 40 hours, you lost that money. That's what you lost. Or if you didn't work, what'd you get? $800 per week. There are 52 weeks in a year. That means in 1 year, you earn $41,600 if you are working. If you are not working, and you could have, but you didn't, for unsound reasons, that's how much you lost. And that's how much you end up in a credit card when you can't even afford it. A person unemployed should not have a credit card.
Right.
Amen.
Otherwise, you plan to write NSF check, and that's a crime. Hello? And wife and husband shouldn't have two separate credit cards, they both spend it uncontrollably. See, in the mirror, you're going to have one, but both Anna have one. Ooh.
Amen.
And if in doubt, do without.
That's right.
My teaching?
Yes.
You know what? I missed the chance. These men did a great job upstairs. We should have a marriage seminar upstairs. But probably some of you guys are not married yet. Yes, you are. You're married to Jesus.
Amen.
To find Mr. Adam. Hello. Now, folks, you know, Sister Dean, I found something out. All those who married guys with a big thing called Adam apple right here. Some guys, they got so worn out, they lost their apple right here. Check you guys out. Do you have an apple still?
Oh,
you lost it.
Yeah.
Everybody else? Oh, boy. I don't want to go there. But look at this. If you live 20 more years, look at what you can make. 41,600 times 20 years equal $832,000. This is what Suncor, Syncrude, call lost up earning.
Right.
That's why they laid you off.
Right.
They failed to make that much money per week per barrel.
That's right.
Yeah.
Don't look at me like that.
That's
why they're going to lay you off.
That's right.
Now, if they're making an adjustment, don't you think you should?
Come on.
Amen.
Yes.
Right.
If they're going to cut back, don't you think you should?
Yes.
If they're going to rearrange their life and stuff, don't you think you should?
Amen.
are you going to say, all things continue as they were from the beginning? Zap, you're out. And then you're going to be a soup kitchen. Look, folks, this is one person making that much. What if the wife is making that much money too? They make $1,664,000. Now, the best question now, why would a two-paycheck wife and husband both spend at the year end, all they have is $5 left? Because they didn't plan. What if one of them spend and the one that's the same? And they have no discrepancy about joint account.
Right.
Because they are together, dream come true.
Amen.
Amen.
Am I preaching?
Amen.
Good. Is like this? Is this good teaching?
Yes.
You know, I'm doing this gossip, Pastor. You preach and record this because the next church coming up, this church, we're going to need this.
Yes.
Yes. That's right.
And I want you to have this ready for them. Gosh, I'm prophesying. I'm going to get a brand new set of young people on there, want to get married, and they have to watch this.
Yes. Right. Amen.
You have to hear everything I'm saying. Before they invest their life or their time in anything else or any person, we have to take a listen to what I'm going to say.
Amen.
There's another group coming. I can see them right now in the spirit.
Hallelujah.
And by the way, God said, talk to the church right now, because right now in McMurray and Alberta, 100,000+ people are fired, laid off.
Right.
Mm-hmm. And therefore, suicide rate has increased.
Amen.
Crime has increased. Divorce has increased. Home closures have increased.
Mm-hmm.
And this goes on. So, I want my people to have an answer to what to do.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
You don't realize that I'm sick and never tell you I'm sick.
Right.
But my healing gave me experience to tell somebody about who can heal them.
Right.
Yes.
Amen.
And I want you to know, beloved, that God placed this church between the beginning of sorrow and the great tribulation.
Right.
And we're right in the middle of it. To the 2 points. I said, we're going to 2 points. We are.
Right.
We're feeling what's going on. But so did Elijah.
Right.
Huh? Yeah. So did Joseph.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. So did Isaac. We are no different.
That's right.
Jesus spent 40 years on the Roman Empire leadership and died when he was what? Not 40, but 40, but 33 years. Now, look at this here. The optimist gained, retired, fulfilled the next day. The pessimist died with pain and regret.
Right.
The greatest regret you're going to have financially is what you didn't do.
Yes.
And you could have done. Now I'm going to talk something. I'm going to touch a real serious spot here. I was taught homeschooling for children. I brought upon that in teaching, our church came from. And now those schools today still continue on. They eventually break up. And sometimes they do it only for the group they have in mind. And once the group get in mind, make sure that they turn over. And so other people get turned into the world and have to deal with it as a problem. But I want to say this to you folks. I'm not giving you no advice what to do with your family. It's up to you. You're not, this is not a salvation and hell issue. Mm-hmm. Understand that?
Right.
You choose what you want to do, and it's your benefit or losses.
Right.
You don't have to do it to please anybody or me or someone else. This is your choice. Now, the impact. So come and let's look at the school situation.
Amen.
God told a missionary in Vancouver, in Michigan, that they should not send their kids to homeschool. It's on the website. And they said, God, why? This is a wicked place. Today, they've got 18 culture in their church. Their kids are still saved and brought people in. This brother had 2 out of 1,000 people in his church.
And most of the kids are won by his kids. So my question was, what's going on here, God? Okay, look at the impact of trying to isolate our kids for the sake of good reason. You should try to do that, like Joseph, like, you know, Moses' parents did. Look at this, isolation. What's wrong? I can't hear this, I see that. Ooh. But you're the results right here. Isolation or insulation. The positive thing is isolation. The negative part is they have no social skills dealing with temptation in the world. The parents are the teachers, but when they come exposed to the real secular world, they have no response. Mm-hmm. Can't deal with it. The positive response is godly education, but when they come to defend their faith, they're intimidated. Mm-hmm. Not able to win others. They refuse to be the salt of the earth. I feel out displaced. Mm-hmm. They can't handle as a candle. They still sin. And we found out that homeschool kids still watch pornographic magazines. Yep. They're porns. Still turn to drugs. I know from our school we had.
That's right.
Some of you become prostitutes, mm-hmm. pimps. The schooling did not deter. Maybe we made them worse off than before. Jesus Christ said that the Pharisees went distant to make a disciple. And when they were through with them, there were twofold child of the devil. I don't want this church to be that.
Amen.
I swear to God, I'll never get into that again, ever. Now, the parental satisfaction impact is they learn with their kids, but they also lose income. Mm-hmm. It's a good sacrifice, but is it really? If the kids don't turn out to be right. Mm-hmm. They hope to save the kids, but if kids come grow up, I don't want to be saved.
Right.
What about the lost money? They wasted their money, wasted their education, wasted their time, trying to save those kids from those situations where the kids let them down.
That's right.
All right? They try to rescue the kids from the ungodly and sinful world, but the kids find it through other mediums.
That's right.
Huh? Mm-hmm. Crept in the house of their bed. We have family who were taken to court, and the kids were taken from their parents, and the kid died from drug OD. And the law is no longer with them. So they turn agents and turn them loose. Get back to their kids. Perverted, destroyed, messed up. Most of these kids get married and to pagans.
Right.
They marry under pagan cultural gods. Gods that we taught them were wrong. Mm-hmm. It did not work. Mm-hmm. So why do these other kids that went to public school survive? Because God said, I send you in the world. So your kids are going with you.
Right.
Right. Go ye in all the world and preach the gospel.
Yes, amen.
Now, I'm not giving you kids that are reading to rebel your parents. I'm going to tell you what the Bible says. God sent us in the world. He knew where he sent us.
Yes.
Among scorpions.
Right.
Yes, amen.
Devils. Mm-hmm. But don't forget, Jesus was also a kid. Don't forget, Samuel was. Don't forget, Joseph was. Mm-hmm. So, Pastor, what are you trying to say? What am I trying to say? Nothing. Before you give up your wage and your education, mm-hmm. and these same kids will grow up and abandon you, their partner will walk up and leave you far away.
That's right.
Now, you're poor. You have no education. You have no career. Mm-hmm. They don't want you to bother them. They're too busy to love their new partner.
Yeah.
And they leave you. Amen? And look what you lost. Mm. I'm going to show what's happened to you now. Now, I'm not talking to parents who are already in situation. I mean, you young people, if you're going to get married, mm-hmm. you can't isolate the devil. You can only insulate your saints to deal with the devil.
Because
those boys are going to watch on their computer and video and all that thing behind your back.
Mm-hmm.
And just as perverted as the ones in the world, like Eli's sons.
That's right.
So the Bible, All right. Saints, here's it. Teamwork makes dream works. So don't compare yourself to the church. Mm-hmm. Let's see, there's a house for $260,000. A house for $260,000. And Saint A makes $29,000 a year. $900. Just by comparativeness, I divide $29,000, I was thinking per year, into the cost of the house, give me an index of 9.66. Now, Saint B in the same church saw you at that house. They only make $12,000 a year. You divide that same $12,000, that same cost of the house, there's no difference in the index.
Right.
Look at Saint C, make $900 a year. In the same index calculation, look at the difference in that. Can you see that?
Yes.
Now, Saint D, stay home and just say, I ain't going to work. I live off POGI. I live off unemployment insurance. And they want a dream home.
Right.
Will it happen? No. They're going to have what? A nightmare. I prove it to you. By calculating. Figures don't lie, but liars make liars out of figures. Uh-huh. I'm trying to talk to you here as if you're paying me $306 an hour to talk to you in my
eyes. Right. Right.
So you can't see the value of me to you, but I'm telling you, my friend, I'm trying to help you.
Yes.
Amen. You've got children underage, and they're going to need a future, yes. And their future is in your change.
Yes.
And your wife and your change, and your kids change, yes. Change, and your understanding of what this is all about. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Well, you can go to some other church that'll never talk about it. Mm-hmm. Well, you're going to go in the ditch. Mm-hmm. Well, the world, you don't have to. Look at this right here. In conclusion, this confession tells me, Saint A, move into a new home. Saint B, after wait 2.3 years before they can do it. Saint C, after wait 3 years. And Saint D, calculated, is indeterminate.
Right.
If you can't wait on your income, then you're going to go into credit you can't afford.
That's right.
So I'm not here to depress you or to shame you if it hits you hard. And if I failed to motivate you, then I really didn't obtain my goal. I still am giving a solution here. That's now 9:15, so I have to stop and then you go home.
Keep going, Pastor.
I want to keep on going.
Yes.
In all of those, you're allowed to go, but close your eyes while you go, please. Your exit is now available. I hear footprints. I'm just not my wife. I want to lose that. Okay. All right. Solution. Goal in life, prepare your family against hard times. Know what to do. Now, avoid splurging. Avoid expensive trip.
That's right.
To see family you don't need to see. They're more at expense than an account benefit. Little home with your family. Once in a while, but too often stinks. Pastor, you don't talk like that. Well, it's your business. Because they want you to give what you don't have.
Right.
And you're too proud to say you can't afford it. Wait, don't waste your money. Purchase layaway. If you rent a car and it's winter time, pay the insurance in full.
Yes.
Because you may crash it. Mm-hmm. It's less to pay for insurance than pay for a brand new car.
Right.
Don't put it on your driver's license. You may be sorry. Hello. All right? Without preparation, you can lose your job, lose your income. There's nothing wrong with that. But don't lose your soul.
Amen.
All right?
Amen.
Collapse can happen to you and the company. Don't be a frog in the kettle. Amen. Right. Build your house a strong, biblical foundation.
Yes.
Count the cost for what you're about to do. All right? Be awakened to your surroundings. McMurray is a place to be, but still there have been downturn and adjustments, so make adjustment with them.
That's right.
Amen.
And really, I was thinking about you folks. I don't know who I'm thinking about in particular, nobody in particular, but I asked God many months ago, many years ago maybe, save it on the side. And when things go bad, you jump from an apartment to a condominium. Uh-huh. Next time they go wreckage, you jump from the condominium to a house. Uh-huh. And after a house, a bungalow. Uh-huh. Well, it's all a matter of how you save.
Right.
And you expect things to happen.
Yes.
But if you waste your money on McDonald's, unnecessary trips,
uh-huh.
then when you're done, you get on the show for it.
That's right.
Everybody needs leisure. But there's some treatment. If you spend on something that don't appreciate, you're wasting your depreciating money. Boy.
Amen.
Lord have mercy. Plan to get out of debt. Get rid of it.
Yes.
Cash is king.
Yes.
Amen.
Yes.
Mortgage is okay. Mm-hmm. Avoid credit card penalties.
Right.
Amen. Don't be married to credit cards.
Amen.
And storage expense. Mm-hmm. Habits is the philosophy of life. Write that down, somebody. Put on the webpage. Your habit is your philosophy of your life. You live by philosophy. And to double up what you've always done, you always get what you've always got. Amen. It's true. All right? Save now, even a dime. You need a financial cushion. You need to plan for 6 months. It won't happen overnight, but slowly plan for it. Mm-hmm. Amen. Get a piggy bank. Stop the wasted. Sit on a pile of cash, not trash. And get interest income. Don't pay it. If you saints were trustworthy and honest, mm-hmm. you could do what they do in England and British Columbia.
Mm-hmm.
10 people every month could give each other $1,000. This first month, I give you $1,000. Mm-hmm. We all give each other $10,000.
Yes.
Next month, you give next person $10,000. What have you just done? Mm-hmm. You beat the interest rate.
Yes.
And in 10 months, you all have what? $10,000 each. Amazing.
Yes.
If you say we're on one accord, you could buy each other a house.
Uh-huh.
And the next time is my house, next time is your house.
That's right.
But some of you could move away too.
Mm.
It wouldn't find you. But the Lord would find you with arrows. Now, folks, it can happen.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
But that's what they do in Victoria and British Columbia. And the bill says houses nobody can buy. You know why they're doing that? To keep you up. Plan for lost job. Survive sudden loss of job. Sudden layoff. Avoid the poverty line. Store food against rising price. Amen. Cook if you have to and don't eat out. For a whole year.
Amen.
And see what you say.
Yes,
that's right. Nothing wrong with that. Amen. You know why? You have to learn to cope. Amen? The problem won't be lack of money, it's the panic attack you have to deal with. The anxiety, the depression, the mental problems, when you can't solve the problem. So I want you to avoid tonight being forced into poverty, or government dependency, or food stamps, or soup kitchen, or EI living off. I want you to avoid it! You can't avoid it, because great is the Lord! I said, great is the Lord. Worship with me. I'm trying to help you. I'm not putting you down. I'm trying to challenge you. I'm saying God will help you. If you plan, I'll plan with you, God said. If you grow, I'll grow with you, God said. Come on, church. It's free advertising from the Lord. Praise God. I'm not saying don't go depressed tonight.
Amen.
I'm just thinking that make $10,000 tonight. Or quit your job tonight. Hard to work tomorrow. I'm saying, I have a long-term plan.
Yes, amen.
Yes.
This is not a yard sprint. It's a marathon.
Yes.
Hallelujah, Jesus.
It's a marathon.
Amen.
I'm passing the baton. Let's worship God. God, teach your kids to to say no to your kids. I don't want my kids to run school meal program. I don't want my kids to be homeless. Amen. Or be parentless, or be dropout, or be caught with truancy. Amen. And when I get hold, I want my kids to know that they're my retirement safety net.
Right.
You better tell those kids that. Boy, I give up jobs for you. I give up a lot of stuff for you. And I get home, you better take care of me. And I'll bust your head off. Uh-huh. I brought you in this world, I'll take you out. Uh-huh. Let's worship the Lord.
Hallelujah.
That's right. Right now, kids are an expense account. They're no asset, they're an expense account. They bleed your pocket.
Right.
Uh-huh. Can all you men say amen?
Amen.
Amen. It's us that got to work our backs off to get it to them.
Amen.
That's right.
That's right.
Come on, man.
Amen.
And kids, when daddy come home, go meet him at the door.
That's right.
Get off his shoes.
Come on.
Oh, God. Take his bag, lunch bag from him.
Mm-hmm.
Treat him with honor.
Yes.
He was in the cold, freezing, where he was locked in a classroom,
amen,
playing games.
Amen.
Don't waste kids' education money on toys. That's no good.
Right.
Amen?
Amen.
Amen. Take care of Isaiah. Amen.
Amen.
Bless him. Amen. Have a vision for your family and your future. Manage your situation. Don't be controlled by it. Plan the next move. Amen. Don't be windblown. Organize your facts. Evaluate your options. And don't be depressed.
Amen.
Recovery. Amen. Is not a sprint. It's a marathon. We're going to have to say, 10 years from now, here's where you want to be.
Amen.
5 years from now, here's where you want to be.
Right.
Don't, and say, 1 year from now, here's where we plan to start. Don't expect to jump to the end right now. It doesn't work that way.
Right.
David was anointed for how long before he became king? How many years? 40 years.
Yes.
But the anointing was on him.
Yes.
To be king.
Yes.
But he waited 40 years. Joseph waited 17 years for the dream to come true. You got a dream home? I haven't been living around to see it, but a friend, God will give it to you.
Hallelujah.
I think God will bless you.
Amen.
Come on, church. I'm king of truth. Amen. Five ways to stop wasting money. All right? I'm going to pass this around here. This is very provocative. Oh, can you speed read? Because I went back real quick. You know, read it. It's one. Only that one.
Just one?
No, you read it first. Oh. And pass it off. In fact, show the wives only. While I'm talking. The first, in fact, tell you what, let's make a copy of these. Who can do this for me, please? Is there a colorful machine anywhere? How many want a copy of this? All right. This is my office, baby. Our staff will get a copy. Our upstairs, I want a lot of copies to give away because I did it for you guys. Upstairs. Or I can put it on the board outside. You can all read as you go along. Ask them these questions to plug the leak of your money drain. Do I really need a line of credit? Do I need a bank credit card? Do I really need an overdraft? Do I really need a Swiss bank? Do I need an ATM in my life? Do I need extended warranties? Do I need to purchase it now? Come on. Do I need a one-time purchase or consider subscription? Do I need more insurance is overinsured? Do I need to do all this shopping this year? Come on. If you follow me and drop Christmas from the holidays, you save a lot of money. We're going to jewelry store. I laugh at the thank God my wife don't wear jewelry. I don't have to buy it. Just walk past it. She don't miss that chain, the earring, the finger ring, the nose ring, the toe ring, and the bowl ring, and all kind of ring. Or the bullring. Don't you go on the trip this year? What are the benefits? Do I need to scrap my budget, the living? hey, family, I can't come and see you, but I'll Skype you cheaper. See them on Skype. What's the difference? What's the difference? When you're in the grave, they won't see you at all. Probably you're in the grave, and everybody missing you. How about overspending? Watch those demons. Oh, the credit card. I have a lot of demons in my wallet. A lot of demons. They're demons. Well, they are. Credit cards are demons. Okay? All right? So, do I need the store credit card? There's certain store when I pass them, I know the demons attack my wife. And I know I got no spirit to drive them out. I can drive into it, but I can't drive out of it. When I park my car, the demons are taking over. And she goes and she shop. And the worst part is she may not buy nothing. That part is good for my pocket. But I wasted all that hours. But a happy wife in the day keep a happy husband at night.
Amen.
I know, you have experience. For the rest of you got no experience. You got a problem. Do I really save by buying this so-called, they call it on the phone, or will it hurt my existing score, my credit score, and it goes on, sure. Now, I got some painted clothes on this here. The emergency kit. I asked my wife, again, do you have these? In case it's said to be one of your physician, yield thyself. Let's stand.
Church?
I don't know how to tell you that I love you, except the way I'm telling you right now. Pass it around, please. Pass it around. Quick. I would suggest you invest if you're working. Lay off insurance. Because it could be there at least 90 days in the system. But we can start drawing from it. You know? I bought insurance with my mom to go on a trip, and she's in her 70s or 80s. I pay a lot of money. But I know the hospital can cost millions. So I was willing to pay to be covered. Amen. I don't think he wants to go to bed. Emergency kit. You store dry food. Mm-hmm. You know what? I'm guilty of this. I got storage with dead clothing I don't need, dead stuff I don't need. You know that. Amen. There should be good stuff stored in there, right? That I could live on. I can't eat nothing in that thing. What a waste. You know what you have in there? Rice, peas, salt fish. What else?
Water.
Not cake, soap, for water. Water tablets. Dry goods can survive. You have to know this upstairs I have hidden from you guys. I bought a meal package to last 20 years famine, and I hid it. You didn't throw it away in the garbage. It's specialized food. But the year I tried to buy it, the year 2000, you know, they told me, American first. And they wouldn't give it to me. But I can pull it out and instantly become instant food. It's survival. Because I'll tell you, we had a Russian McMurray one time on groceries. The fire. Within a day, every supermarket was empty.
Yeah, that's right.
I learned the danger of having my car full of gas. Because if you have to leave the city in a hurry, you have to drive at least 150 miles to this gas station. Church, be wise. Even Acts, winter garments, lights, candles, knife kit, first aid kit, sewing kit, camping equipment, compass. I can't read a compass, but I don't get one anyway. Hiking backpack, water clothing, a life jacket, a blown up book. You can be traveling down the road and all of a sudden water comes up and you can't get up. It can happen to you. We don't think so, do we? Do we have batteries? And the list goes on, church. I gave you before information on that. I want to stop. You've been so kind to me in time. And my throat's coming back. I'm so grateful for that. It's your sorrow and my gladness. What do you think? You still want to get married? After all that punishment?
Yes, sir.
You love punishment?
Yes, I do.
Well, she loved punishment. Well, God have mercy on her. God bless you. You still want to get married? You still want to stay home, wife? Anybody else? And that's that? I think I may be in your hand. You think you can handle that? He's smart. He said no. It's no fun. I mean, maybe it's. It's a work. Any question on this side? Be honest with church. Be honest with me. Come on. Open up to me. Because after church, I'm not talking to you. Come on.
I have a question, Pastor.
Come on, close to me. Use the back.